we had reviewed the sort of state of affairs that were in place as of the spring and summer and early fall of 1963, the year following the resolution of the Cuban Missile Crisis, and that there was this ascending crescendo of activities on the part of John Kennedy to take steps to respond to the experience that he had had during the Cuban Missile Crisis, in which the Joint Chiefs of Staff were pursuing a set of policies that were very similar to what had happened to Kennedy when he first came to office in the early months of 1961, when he came on board as the new president and was confronted by the fact that the Central Intelligence Agency and the Joint Chiefs of Staff had planned this invasion of Cuba under Richard Nixon in anticipation of the fact that Richard Nixon was going to be reelected. But when he wasn't reelected, they were compelled to have to brief Kennedy on the fact that they had this 400-man incursion force that was going to be going onto the beach at the Bay of Pigs, and they were trying to get Kennedy to support it with U.S. military air cover and sending in United States Marines to support them. And Kennedy refused to do that. Now, I point out that the fact of the matter is that it wasn't uncommon for the United States executive branch to dispatch military forces of the United States into Latin America to assert United States interests as they perceived them, which tended to coincide with the corporate interests of their funders, because there had been some 40 different incidents since 1890 up until 1962 when the United States executive branch had in fact deployed U.S. military forces into Latin America to intervene in the conduct of the affairs of one or another of the countries in South America. In fact, we've got a list of them here that I've got that I can hook these up and send them to you later. But for example, they start out in 1890 in Argentina, was sending U.S. troops into Argentina to protect the U.S. interests, and then they proceed down through the years. They proceed down through the years, one after another, after another, after another, after another, and they just keep going. And the United States executive branch had deployed U.S. forces into one or another of the Latin American countries some 40 times, as I pointed out. So Kennedy's refusal to allow U.S. military forces to be deployed in support of an attempt to oust a, quote, uncooperative government from Cuba was the dramatic exception to the rule that had been allowed to unfold over the years. And so that started the relationship between Kennedy and the CIA and the Joint Chiefs of Staff. And this had proceeded all the way up to 2 years, almost 3 years later with the Cuban Missile Crisis, where all of the forces, the CIA and the Joint Chiefs of Staff, they all combined to try to put this extraordinary pressure on Kennedy to go to war with the Soviet Union over Cuba and to launch a full-scale military invasion of Cuba. And as you remember that night of October 27th, 28th, when the Joint Chiefs unanimously voted to go to invade the island of Cuba with full knowledge that it was going to result in a nuclear exchange between the Soviet Union and the United States. And Kennedy had just emphatically defied them and refused to go along with that, and ordered the standing down from DEFCON 2, agreed to take the missiles out of Turkey, opened up the back channel to Castro, and began this dialogue with Khrushchev about having a nuclear disarmament treaty. And he had succeeded during the months of 1963, following the October 1962 Cuban Missile Crisis. Following its resolution at the end of October, he had started to take steps which ended up coming to fruition in securing a partial test ban treaty that banned all experimentation and detonation of nuclear weapons anywhere in the atmosphere, anywhere beneath the oceans, and anywhere in outer space. And he had issued the directive to the State Department to follow up on this step one with an additional two steps in the treaty negotiation process that were ultimately going to result in the disassembly of the nuclear warheads of both the United States and the Soviet Union. So that this situation that obtained, as we pointed out on Tuesday, resulted in two different instances in which Kennedy had been warned not to go into Miami or Chicago because there were actual active plans to assassinate him if he went into either one of those two cities. But he eventually made the decision to go to Dallas in November of 1963, after having issued the National Security Action Memorandum directing the beginning of the removal of troops from Vietnam and to go forward with the nuclear test ban treaty. What we did at the very end of the discussion on Tuesday is I put up I drew on the board the beginnings of a major graphic that sort of showed you the state of affairs that Kennedy faced at the beginning of November of 1963. One of the last activities of which was the attempt on the part of the CIA and the anti-Castro Cuban exile community in Miami to have a landing party land in Cuba on board the USS Rex that was at that time under the lease of a company by the name of Collins Radio. It was turned back. And so that what I want to do today is I want to, in preparation for us to move into the events of November 22nd down in Dallas, I want to give you the kind of detailed schematic of what it was that actually confronted Kennedy, what it was that he was defying when he was engaged in this type of activity. And I hasten to emphasize that the reason for the discussions we're going to have next week, in week eight, is to go through the details of the Kennedy assassination, not getting right down to the angles of declination of the shots that hit Kennedy and Governor Connally, but to give you the general background layout of the facts that surround the entire assassination. All of that is just to emphasize the lengths to which the cabal is willing to go to stop anyone from getting in the way of the effectuation of their mission. And you will remember that in the Doolittle Commission report that was written by William D. Pawley, William D. Pawley not only stated that the mission had to be undertaken to create a paramilitary operational agency that was able to engage in activities that were more ruthless than those that would ever be deployed by the enemy, but in saying that the people of the United States would eventually have to become to be made familiar with the details of this repugnant philosophy. In abandoning all of the concepts of fair play because there were no rules in such a game. And you'll recall that in that memorandum, what William Pawley said is, no one should be allowed to stand in the way of the carrying out of this mission. Very interesting way that he put that. But so what you have here is Kennedy having taken the steps to try to undo this entire operation that these people had in place, the cabal had in place. And so what I want to do is I want to go over today, and then we can discuss it, and you can ask questions about it. I don't know, we've got the other overhead in case we have to set it up over in the other shop. I don't know yet, but we've got it. We've got this overhead here, but we can set it up over there if we need to. But this is what we're talking about here. As you can see, I guess I'll stay out of your way. I guess this is a little awkward, but it is quite long, this thing. That you see, there, Patty said there's some building getting ready to fall down right next door that we took this out of. But this is what I pointed out to you was the core of this operation. This is Brown Brothers Harriman. This is the private investment firm on Wall Street who is represented by Sullivan and Cromwell, this law firm here. And Alan Dulles here, who is the attorney for Brown Brothers Harriman, is a senior partner in Sullivan and Cromwell. And Cromwell, who was the founder of this, William Cromwell, who's the founder of Sullivan and Cromwell, is the guy that is primarily responsible for the Panama Canal. He's the one that ended up being paid some $200,000 by the French consortium that owned a lot of the land in Panama that was going to be used for the canal. And he, as an attorney, represented them. And this was in the context of this series of some 40 interventions that had been made in South America, in Latin America, between 1890 and in 1900 by that time, almost that many by that time. And so this, as I point out, is the core of this operation. You remember this, the CEO of Brown Brothers is George Herbert Walker, who is in fact the grandfather of George H.W., that's George Herbert Walker Bush, because his son-in-law was Prescott Bush, who was put in charge of being the CEO of Brown Brothers Harriman when George Herbert Walker went on to found the Union Bank of New York. In the Union Bank of New York is the facility that you'll see that in conjunction with the Bank of Shipping and Commerce in the Netherlands with Fritz Thyssen in Helmer Schacht, that is the group that funded Adolf Hitler and Germany and set up the entire Third Reich in Germany as the bulwark against Bolshevism in Europe. So this is the central core of this operation. And it's only later that it devolves into George Herbert Walker and the Central Intelligence Agency and the other operations that we'll get to. But this is the core. And Alan Dulles here is going to be one of the principals because, as we'll point out next week, Alan Dulles is the man who was the field marshal for putting together the assassination of President Kennedy. Not in his capacity as the disgruntled, fired director of the Central Intelligence Agency, which he was, that after the Bay of Pigs fiasco in April of 1961, Kennedy left him in place to save face. But in the fall of 1961, he was let go by Kennedy and terminated in a very embarrassing way. And it wasn't that he was humiliated publicly. What it was is that the status that he had as the as the legal counsel for Brown Brothers Harriman was the power that gave him the authority to be made the head of the first civilian director of the Central Intelligence Agency under Richard Nixon and Dwight D. Eisenhower in 1953. So even though he was fired by Kennedy, he still retained that power that he had as the legal counsel for this particular group here. And that, as you'll note, senior partners in Brown Brothers Harriman included Robert Lovett and Robert Anderson. And Robert Lovett and Anderson were the two of the three trustees, along with John J. McCloy, of the Anderson Trust that Edward Lansdale was instrumental in getting set up by finding these 12 troves of treasure in the Philippines in 1945 that you recall us talking about. So that you have these guys here with the Anderson Trust, Robert Lovett and Robert Anderson, senior partners in Brown Brothers Harriman, being two of the three trustees of the Anderson Trust. And Charles Willoughby is the other fellow who, when Ed Lansdale, who found the treasure, went to General MacArthur in the Philippines, who was, or in Singapore, who was in 1945 the commanding general in charge of the Pacific, the forces in the Pacific, that General MacArthur sent his G2, his head of intelligence, Charles Willoughby, to go with Ed Lansdale to go to Washington, D.C. to report this to Truman. And Truman, rather than make this public or notify the Congress or take into possession the $1.2 trillion in gold and silver and platinum and jewels, put it into the hands of Robert Lovett and Robert Anderson as senior partners in Brown Brothers Harriman, along with John J. McCloy. Now, this is, again, as you move out from the center of power of this particular group, and you have Alan Dulles as their attorney, and you have the Union Bank of New York that was established, you have the Sullivan and Cromwell, you have now the Anderson Trust in place, then what you have is the at the end of World War II, you have Robert Lovett, one of the guys who is one of the trustees of the Anderson Trust. He is the one who is first assigned responsibility for coming up with an idea of establishing the Central Intelligence Agency, which he does. And William Pawley, who is partners with, he's a business partner of the law partner of John J. McCloy. And he is selected to be the guy who writes the Doolittle Report. And the Doolittle Report has William Pawley on it and a fellow named Morris Hadley and William Franken. And Morris Hadley is the law partner of John J. McCloy. Now, I don't want to get too intricate about the whole thing, but the fact of the matter is what we're saying here is that we're talking about a group of some dozen men who are all interrelated here at the core of this entire operation that's going on. And through the Anderson Trust, this $1.2 trillion that you bring in Charles Willoughby, who is brought in by General MacArthur as soon as they find the thing. And when General MacArthur is made the commander, who is the head of all Allied forces in the Pacific at the end of World War II, he is when the Korean War breaks out in 1950, he is appointed to be the head of Allied power, the Allied military troops in Korea. And he insists in Korea, I have a sneeze coming on, but when he's confronted by the Chinese coming out of China to push back Allied forces, they're all 99% United States forces in the Korean War. When they are pushed back at the battle of the reservoir, big, anyway, there's a big Incheon reservoir, they end up being pushed back, and General MacArthur insists upon using nuclear weapons. He wants to detonate 25 to 50 atomic bombs along the border between Korea and China, and so that the Chinese troops can't come through because there'd be a deadly radiation area there. And so he's insisting upon doing this, and President Truman resists him doing this. And so, in fact, General MacArthur goes around publicly speaking out against Truman about how he's weak on communism. And so Truman relieves him of his command and assigns him to some other command. And General MacArthur views that as an affront and resigns or retires. And he brings with him his chief of state, his chief of intelligence, Charles Willoughby, and H.L. Hunt out of Dallas, Texas, and William Pawley here. They finance bringing General MacArthur to Dallas in 1951, and they bring him in, and they have a huge ticker tape parade for him, and they open an office of MacArthur for President. And this entire group of people are in the process of considering getting General MacArthur made President of the United States in 1952. And so this is what's going on down in Dallas. And Charles Willoughby, his G2, or Chief of Intelligence, now retired, joins together with H.L. Hunt, the man who paid for, along with William Pawley, bringing MacArthur into Dallas. They set up a thing called the Foreign Intelligence Digest and Field Operations Intelligence. These are two completely civilian groups that are not connected officially with any organization whatsoever, but they're established with the finances of H.L. Hunt and William Pawley, and they established these two organizations to engage in domestic surveillance, political surveillance, against people that they think might be subversive, such as the American Civil Liberties Union and the NAACP and other groups of that kind. In the meantime, of course, what's happened here is they have set up, because of the recommendations that were made originally by Robert Lovett and by William Pawley, they end up setting up the Central Intelligence Agency here, which is eventually going to be directed by George Herbert Walker Bush, the son of the grandson of George Herbert Walker, and the son of Prescott Bush, ends up heading up the Central Intelligence Agency, okay? And that this is set up immediately at the end of World War II, and this is working in direct connection with this Latin American operating base here. This is the operation that got set up by taking the Nazis out of Germany through the Odessa, which is the secret operation that was set up in coordination with the OSS to sneak the fascists that were the head of the Nazi government and the SS command structure of the Waffen-SS out of Germany. And they're brought down into South America, and they set up this Latin American operating base for the fascists. And they're working in direct connection with the Central Intelligence Agency. Now, you remember me telling you the story about in Mexico City, the operating base in Latin America where all the fascists were, in Brazil and Peru and in Uruguay and Paraguay, etc. It's important to point out that, in fact, William D. Pawley, right after the war, was made the ambassador to Peru and Brazil. And he had all kinds of business interests in Cuba as well. He was, in fact, business partners with Batista, who is the dictator in Cuba. And they set up the Southeast Asian Supply Corporation down in Cuba, and they're business partners with Batista, and they're actually smuggling heroin out of Southeast Asia into Cuba were Paul Helliwell, who is a full-time employee of the Central Intelligence Agency, is running the Sea Supply Corporation, the Southeast Asia Supply Corporation, and they're using money to purchase military equipment and explosives, which are in fact the monies are being given to Commerce International over here. And Commerce International was founded actually by William D. Pawley. You see this over here. And it in fact is a subsidiary of this Commerce International is a subsidiary of the World Business Corporation, which I guess isn't on here yet. Okay, but anyway, these same people that are functioning here, the William D. Pawley, John J. McCloy, is made the Governor General in Germany. Post-World War II Germany, John J. McCloy, who was, as I mentioned, sitting in the private box of Adolf Hitler in the Olympic Games in 1934, is made the Governor General in Germany at the end of World War II. And John J. McCloy turns out to be part of what they call here the Berlin Operating Base. The Berlin Operating Base is the base of operations that was set up in Germany at the end of World War II. And you have operating in this operation, Alan Dulles, who's there, John J. McCloy, who is the Governor General. The CIA sets up a station. Theodore Shackley is part of that. William Harvey is part of that. Frank Wisner, David Morales, and all of these people who are going to become very well known to us next week, they're all in the thing called the Berlin Operating Base. And it's an OSS operation over here. It's an OSS operation originally and becomes a Central Intelligence Agency operation. So what you see here is that this power center that has generated these people like William Pawley and John J. McCloy, Robert Lovett and Robert Anderson and the Anderson Trust are now linked with Charles Willoughby and MacArthur in setting up the Foreign Intelligence Digest in the Field Operations Intelligence funded by H.L. Hunt and William Pawley. And they're actually functioning as a completely unofficial domestic political surveillance operation of the Central Intelligence Agency over here. Okay, but they're functioning completely independently. And it'll become very important because you'll discover that Lee Harvey Oswald ends up working for the Foreign Intelligence Digest, working for H.L. Hunt and Charles Willoughby and William Pawley after he comes back from Russia, which we'll go into this next week. And as I say, you see that William Pawley, who was instrumental in setting these up with Charles Willoughby, that William D. Pawley, who was the ambassador to Peru and Brazil working with the fascists, is a very powerful individual. And he is the guy that you'll remember on Tuesday I told you about Operation Tilt, where William D. Pawley on his yacht, the Flying Tiger II, went down into Cuba after President Kennedy had found out about the S-Force and the political assassination group and had ordered them to stand down from any attempt to assassinate Castro. And in fact, William D. Pawley organized this group, Operation Tilt, and these are the people that were involved in it with Eddie Bio, Rip Robertson, John Martino, Rudy Enders, Richard Billings was the Life magazine guy, and this fellow you hear about tomorrow, Tosh Plumley, who flew the PBY, that flew them the airborne boat that flew them down to Cuba. Because Billings and Plumley are two of our sources that are giving us the details of what it is that happened during that operation. Okay? So that what you see is you see the power kind of emanating out from these people, setting up these operations with secret funding and the secret intelligence operations that are functioning domestically in complete violation of the charter of the Central Intelligence Agency, which prohibits any such domestic surveillance at all. And you see that that the CIA sets up a Mexico City station that I told you that they run a thing called Operation Condor down here, which is the fascist drug operation, which is funding the assassination program, which you remember Joseph Burkholder Smith told us about when Tom Polgar was brought on to be the new CIA station chief in Mexico City by Theodore Shockley. And Theodore Shockley over here is the guy that sat right under Reinhard Galen over here. Theodore Shockley sat directly under him as his deputy and working directly for the Central Intelligence Agency. Okay? So that what you see is you see the spiraling out from this core group of people that are private investment people with Brown Brothers Harriman. You start seeing this, all of this energy that's cycling out from them. The only unit, though it's an important one, the only unit of the Central Intelligence Agency is the only thing that is actually an official government agency. All the rest of this stuff is all private. They're all private people making recommendations to the executive branch, to Truman, as to what they should be doing. And the Anderson Trust is completely privatized. It's run by McCloy and Anderson and Lovett. That these guys are all, the two of them are senior partners in Brown Brothers Harriman. That what you have is an entire private operation pushing for policies that are supportive of their clients. J.P. Morgan and John D. Rockefeller, David Rockefeller, Harriman, Irene DuPont, and these just as examples of the people that are the private investors for Brown Brothers Harriman. But these are guys that are all represented by Sullivan and Cromwell in general, and specifically by Alan Dulles, who is the first CIA civilian director. Okay, so this, and William D. Pawley has set up this private operation, which is the Flying Tigers. You recall that his yacht was the Flying Tigers too. And he runs the Flying Tigers along with Henry Luce and Claire Booth Luce and these folks who are actually flying the military equipment over to Chiang Kai-shek in China. Again, a completely private operation. The Flying Tigers is privately funded by William Pawley and by Claire Booth Luce, the wife of Henry Luce. And so that they have this entire kind of private foreign policy going on, funded by these multimillionaires. And these multimillionaires and their lawyers here are recommending to Truman that he establish this Central Intelligence Agency so that there'll be an official government organization that is working with them and on behalf of all of these private organizations. And it becomes surprising in a certain sense, I think, even to these people, that the Central Intelligence Agency eventually decided that it would actually engage in political assassinations. Whereas they thought that these were going to be doing some more of the things that, if found out about, would not be shameful and scandalous. But in fact, they took advantage of the fact that they were a secret clandestine organization to actually go so far as to set up the S force that where'd our S force end up here? Right over here. Okay, so they set up. They're working directly through Mexico City with the Latin American operating base of the fascists, and they're working with through Pemex, the National Oil Company of Mexico, the president of which is Jorge Diaz Serrano, who is the previous business partner with George Herbert Walker, right here, who becomes the director of the Central Intelligence Agency later after Dulles. Not immediately after Dulles, but shortly thereafter. So what we're dealing with here is a horrendous set of secrets, not the least of which is the existence of this Odessa that is set up working with the OSS at the end of World War II to sneak the Nazis out of Germany into Latin America to set up this kind of fascist operation that's going on out of Mexico City, which is running Operation Mongoose, Operation Condor here, which is a major assassination operations with a drug operation. And they're working directly with the mafia, with Santos Trafficante, who is the don of the mafia in Havana and a business partner of Batista. And they're working in Cuba, shipping the heroin in from the Golden Triangle and sending the money to the Commerce International right here. So what you have here is a full scale operation with different corporations functioning. Over here you have the World Business, the World Commerce Corporation, which is headed up by William Donovan, who is the former head of the OSS during World War II. Up here, there's the OSS. That the World Commerce Corporation is headed up by William Donovan, and it is the parent company of the Commerce International over here, which is handling the drug money and stuff that's coming in. It's headed up by William Pawley, and they're handling the drug money that is coming in from the Southeast Asia Supply Company run by Paul Helliwell. And the materials being brought in, the military equipment that are being purchased by the Commerce International, and it's being flown by the Flying Tigers into China. Okay, so this is a visual of the activities that were going on in the organizational structure that was confronting John Kennedy when he came to office, and it was viewed by Richard Nixon as basically being supportive of Richard Nixon. And Richard Nixon's, well, you could actually say it the other way, that Richard Nixon, as the vice president and chair of the 5412 committee in the Central Intelligence Agency, was being supportive of the policies of these guys. I mean, that's what's so important to really understand. It isn't that these private organizations have been set up to be supportive of the government. It's the other way around. The Central Intelligence Agency has been created to be supportive of their policies. And their policies have been going on, you know, from this entire period from 1890 all the way up to 1963, when Kennedy comes in 1961, that these people are used to governing, they and their fathers and grandfathers are used to governing from the shadows, from their offices on Wall Street, in that they're being assigned to head up groups like the Doolittle Commission and the Anderson Trust and all these things. They're operating these private source of funds for their operations that are completely out from under the review of the Congress. They're completely out from under the review of either of the two political parties. They're functioning on behalf of their long-term interests. And the problem is that the two political parties, the Republicans and Democrats, are basically operating on the theory that what's good for the businesses of these people is indirectly good for the United States. That they're generating huge amounts of capital. They're generating huge amounts of products. They're generating jobs in businesses, et cetera. And therefore, the very concept of fascism that had developed in Europe, pursuant to which the corporations would work hand in glove with the government, and that the government would generate taxes that would end up subsidizing the corporations, and the corporations would end up building military equipment and products for people, and then the private profits could be kept by the stockholders. This is the operation that that was in place. Virtually every single aspect of this whole structure and operation was in place in 1961 when Kennedy, at the very end of this whole long process of setting all these operations up, when Kennedy came in 1961, actually, he was supported by all these people, as Richard Nixon and Eisenhower had been, but he's supported by all of these people and all of these structures only so long as he does what it is that they want done. And when he decides that he's going to have something else done other than what they want, he is no longer supported by them. He is opposed by them. And so he ends up discovering himself by 1963. By 1963, after the resolution of the Cuban Missile Crisis, when he starts moving toward disassembling the nuclear weapons and establishing détente with the Soviet Union and normalizing relations with Cuba, he finds himself being not only no longer supported by this entire structure, he finds himself being opposed by this entire structure. And so that one has to ask oneself, you know, what are the consequences of a president of the United States finding himself confronted by this entire apparatus? Now, we have some idea as to what the consequences of that could be from 1934, when this same cabal, less fully developed, but still made up of the people in the core of this, with the exception of George Herbert Walker Bush, who was too young, but his grandfather and father, this crowd here are the ones that are in power already. When in 1934, Franklin Delano Roosevelt decides that he is going to try to separate out the policies of the United States government, both domestic policy and foreign policy, from the interests of these major stockholders. And they undertake the effort to oust him, to mount a military coup against him. Now, in 1963, when President Kennedy found himself with this whole group arrayed against him, I mentioned to you, and I raise it because tomorrow is the 13th of May, and in the motion picture, 7 days in May, is the motion picture that John Kennedy asked John Frankenheimer to produce and direct, because he wanted the American people to see the story. The fellow who was the author, I can't remember his name right now, but the fellow who was the author of this book, 7 Days in May, he had interviewed see if you can find that for me, with the author of 7 Days in May. There's two of them, but the main guy is a guy that he was a reporter for the Chicago Tribune, and he interviewed the chief of staff, Air Force chief of staff, Curtis LeMay, good old Curtis LeMay. He interviewed Curtis LeMay, and in the interview, on the record, General Curtis LeMay said that Kennedy was a spineless son of a bitch. And he told him this as the sitting chief of staff of the Air Force, talking about the president. And the fellow who was the reporter from there, who was the, if you find it, it's just seven days.
The author is Fletcher Knebel and Charles W. Bailey.
Is Fletcher Knebel is the guy. Fletcher Knebel was the reporter for the Chicago Tribune who interviewed LeMay, and he was so shocked at the kind of vitriol that was being communicated by him about Kennedy, that he sat down and wrote this book. And he researched it a bit, and he realized that that Kennedy was being confronted by these people by the middle of 1963. And he wrote the book, and John Kennedy read the book. And at a particular dinner, a White House dinner, he asked Pierre Salinger. Pierre Salinger told this to me. I was working with Pierre Salinger. Pierre Salinger and Bob Wagner, the former Democratic mayor of New York, were the honorary campaign chairman of the 1972 Democratic presidential campaign. And I was working with them. And Pierre Salinger told me that he had been asked directly by Kennedy at this dinner to go over and talk to John Frankenheimer and ask Frankenheimer to make a movie out of this book, 7 Days in May. And I would recommend that you see it because that you won't notice it's one of those little trivia things, but at the beginning of the movie where Jiggs, who is the deputy to the chief of staff, and in that case they have the chief of staff of the Joint Chiefs of Staff being Curtis LeMay, the chief of staff of the Air Force, played by Burt Lancaster. And his deputy is Kirk Douglas, this guy Jiggs they call him. And when they're walking in, when he's walking into the Pentagon at the beginning of the movie, there is this electric clock there that shows that it's May 13th. And that's when the 7 days in May begin. So every year, it's good to revisit 7 days in May and get to watch it and understand what's going on. Because what's happening in the plot line that you'll see is that the president of the United States, who in the movie is President Lyman, which is interesting because the real head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff is Lyman Lemonser in real life. And he's President Lyman. He has entered into an agreement with Khrushchev to disarm the nuclear missiles. And he's bringing a test ban treaty before the United States Senate. And that there's a debate going on in Washington about this, and the Joint Chiefs of Staff have all assembled themselves against it. And the Chief of Staff of the Air Force, who is the head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, played by Burt Lancaster, James Mattoon Scott, is speaking out publicly against the treaty. And the story in both the book and the movie revolve around this decision being made on the part of the Joint Chiefs of Staff and some extreme right-wing elements in the country to basically mount a military coup against the President of the United States. And now this, as I said, is precisely what happened back in 1934 when Franklin Roosevelt moved in that particular instance, not on the foreign policy level, but on the domestic level against these people, trying to rein them in because their activities had caused the massive depression of 1929. And he was elected president in 1932. And by 1934, he had undertaken such aggressive steps to try to rein in their conduct and regulate them that they decided they were going to mount this coup against him. Also, you'll recall that on the foreign policy level, these people were all organized to keep the United States from going into the war, World War II, against Germany. So that Germany had not only invaded Poland in 1939, but marched on into France. They had taken back the entire Sudetenlands in Rhinelands, and they'd gone into Austria, and they were into France. They set up the Vichy French government, and they had complete control basically of all of Europe, and were firebombing England, so that all of our allies in World War I against Germany were all being destroyed by Germany and taken under German control. And still the United States could not be mobilized to go to war against Germany to protect their traditional allies because of this group. This whole group of these people were all combined together to try to stop Franklin Roosevelt from going to war. And that's why, as I mentioned to you a couple weeks ago, Franklin Roosevelt took this extraordinary step of actually luring the Japanese into attacking the United States Navy in Pearl Harbor. And it gave Roosevelt a justification for getting Congress to declare war on Japan. And then, as I pointed out, still shockingly, that the United States never did declare war on Germany. Germany declared war on the United States because they were an ally of Japan. And the United States had declared war on Japan in response to the attack. So you see that both on the domestic level and on the foreign policy level, Franklin Roosevelt had the exact same problem with these exact same people. And now, that's in 1934, 30 years later, in 1963, Kennedy finds himself directly opposed by these same people. So the question that really arises is, you know, if these people and or their fathers, you know, literally their fathers, were willing, and you have people like, that here's David Rockefeller, who's the son of John D. Rockefeller. You have Averill Harriman, who's the son of E.H. Harriman. You have Irene DuPont, who is the son of Alex Rainey DuPont, Alexis. The sons are now in place, and they again find themselves confronting the President of the United States, because the President of the United States is engaged in a major foreign policy set of decisions in which he is going to order the disassembly of the nuclear weapons that they believe give them the unique strategic advantage over the Soviet Union. And very importantly, remember that General MacArthur was attempting to utilize against the Chinese back in 1952. He wanted to detonate the atomic bombs that we had control over uniquely. He wanted to use them against China, and Truman ordered him to stand down. It wouldn't let him do it. So you have this entire array of people here who believe that they're in this unique position of possessing vast superiority over the Soviet Union and, of course, China in the nuclear weapons field. And these people want to utilize that distinct advantage that they have in order to establish hegemony over the world. So they can get access to the resources anywhere in the world that they want for their corporations. And this is this is how they were set up. And they had the World Commerce Corporation and the Commerce International were set up to be the global business corporations that could help coordinate the activities of all of these people. And President Kennedy, not only, most dramatically, 90% of what they were upset about was, in fact, his foreign policy of preparing to establish détente with the Soviet Union, but most importantly, disassemble the nuclear warheads that these people thought gave them the distinct advantage that they had. But on the domestic front, he had now begun to move in support of the federal civil rights movement that Kennedy had gotten totally offended at some of the conduct of the people in the South. And even though there was this longtime alliance that had existed in the Democratic Party ever since the Civil War, because the Republican Party of Abraham Lincoln are the ones that freed the slaves and had generated the Civil War basically against the South on behalf of the industrialists. So the Democrats had taken advantage of recruiting all of the right wing racists into the Democratic Party, and so Kennedy was faced with this challenge that the Democratic Party had this alliance with all of these reactionary racists in the South in the Democratic Party, but he had gone forward and begun to undertake a protection and defense of the civil rights of black people, that he had sent troops into the South to integrate some of the state universities, etc. And in fact, very specifically, General Walker, who was in Texas, Edmund Walker was this extreme fascist right-wing military officer in the United States Army. He was distributing fascist literature to all of his officers and troops in the Army. And General Lemonser, who, where's my Joint Chiefs of Staff here? There they are, up on the top. That General Lemonser, way up here, Major General Lyman Lemonser, had actually endorsed General Walker distributing this John Birch Society material to his military troops. And it's important to realize that this Walker and his people had mobilized in support of the fascists and the racists. And under the Kennedy administration, General Walker had actually gone to, was it the University of, it was outside of New Orleans. So it must have been the University of Louisiana. They had a major set of demonstrations. Do you know where it was?
Tulane?
It may have been Tulane. I'm not sure where it was. But there was a major demonstration on one of the universities, the campuses outside of New Orleans, because black people were getting set to be admitted to the university, and there was a physical riot.
Old Miss.
Yep. That's where it was, Old Miss. That there was a riot there, and General Walker, who had been fired by Kennedy for defying him and distributing this fascist literature to his officers, led a whole team of people, armed people, onto the campus of the University of Old Miss, and had confronted the black students with military power. And Kennedy had ordered in the National Guard, and the state governor refused to send in the National Guard, and so Kennedy had sent in United States military soldiers to enforce the Federal Civil Rights Act. And so that on both the domestic front and more especially on the foreign policy front, Kennedy had gotten completely crossways with these particular people. And so this was the array of people. And as I said, that just the Central Intelligence Agency here, and there it'd be their Mexico office here, is in the Pentagon up here, are the only operations that you see virtually on the entire board here that were government agencies. All the rest of these things, all the rest of these people, all the rest of these entities are completely private. And yet, this is the power in the United States. These are the men and these are the organizations that were actually dictating the foreign and domestic policy of the United States when President Kennedy became president and took office in January of 1961. And so that he ran directly up against these people virtually immediately with regard to the Bay of Pigs incident. And he took the unique, historically unique position of what? What happened?
There was a bug on the projector.
Oh, a bug on the projector. Oh, all right. All right. So look at the bottom line is, oh, I see right there. These creepy guys. Yeah. See? Guy Bannister. I told you so. See? Guy Bannister. Come on. Get out of there, guy. So this is the power in the United States that was arrayed waiting to support Kennedy, because as you remember, John Kennedy was the son of Joseph P. Kennedy, who was an apologist for Hitler. And he was part of this whole array of people. He had been a bootlegger during the Prohibition and eventually had ended up owning lots of stock in the Shenley Liquor Company. And that's where his millions came from, that gave him the kind of financial clout that enabled him to help finance the election of John to the Congress, to the House of Representatives of Massachusetts, and then to the United States Senate. And so as I mentioned, back in 1937, John Kennedy himself, between his junior and senior year at Harvard College, had gone to Germany with his father and had toured around and was very, very supportive of what he saw. In that he was speaking in glowing terms of Hitler and the fascist economic system that they had in Germany, and he wrote about it in his diary. So these people had a sense that he was going to be supportive of their policies. And so when he confronted them at the Bay of Pigs, and even when they tried to trap him into sending in the United States Marines to support the invasion at the Bay of Pigs, and he still defied them. And as you remember, I told you that we discovered actually right in this an iteration of this class 2 years ago, people who were among the longtime learners came right up out of the audience and gave us the names and dates and details of, as a United States Marine, having been put on one of the ships to stand off the shore of Cuba during the April 17th Bay of Pigs invasion under orders to get ready to go ashore. Even after Kennedy had explicitly ordered the United States Pentagon not to send any military support for this. And so Kennedy was really furious when he found out about this, as we've reviewed in the past, and he ended up firing not only CIA Director Dulles, but Charles Cabell, who was his deputy, and Richard Bissell, who was in charge of the covert operations out of the Miami station. He fired all of them. Now that's a serious move. And then they still kept on coming, these guys, in the person of the Joint Chiefs, and came to him in May of 62 and actually proposed to him initiating a first strike, a sneak attack against the Soviet Union, saying that they were convinced that we had such a vast superiority over the Russians with regard to our missiles that we could attack them in a complete surprise attack and flatten their nuclear defenses and kill probably 200 million people, you know, but eliminate the threat of communism to these people. And Kennedy was so offended by that that he, in fact, relieved Lemenser of his position as the head of the Joint Chiefs. So that was another move that he engaged in. And then when they came back to him again and they proposed Operation Northwoods, in which they proposed, you know, dressing up the anti-Castro Cuban exiles in Cuban military uniforms and attacking Guantanamo and killing American sailors and sinking American ships and blowing up shopping malls and stuff in Miami and attacking tourist centers and stuff in Washington, D.C., and blaming it on Cuba so they could invade Cuba and occupy it. Kennedy, again, defied them and made it very clear that he was insulted by these recommendations that they were making. And so the estrangement between Kennedy and the Joint Chiefs themselves has been focused upon by some people as saying, well, the Joint Chiefs must have been the ones that decided to kill him. But all that it required was for the Joint Chiefs to be willing for him to die. It doesn't require them having done it. And we need to remember that that there was, in fact, a group that was already trained and were ready to be fielded to engage in these types of political assassinations. So what didn't have to be the Joint Chiefs of Staff, there was someone already to do this. What one has to ask oneself is that given this array of predominantly 98% private organizations and private people being offended by what it was that Kennedy was doing, when in fact you find a person here, Lee Harvey Oswald, being accused of having gunned down the president on the streets in Dallas, after two separate instances of the president being ordered not to go to Miami and not to go to Chicago because there were credible threats that he was going to be assassinated in a triangular crossfire with high-powered rifles from off the open windows of office buildings, and he ends up getting charged with killing the president, you have to begin to ask yourself, who is this Lee Harvey Oswald? And how does he relate, if at all, to this whole operation? Because that's what we're going to begin to talk about when we get together at the beginning of this next week. Because it's going to be in this larger context that we begin to investigate. And when we start to find out some things about Lee Harvey Oswald, when we find out, for example, that he was working for the Foreign Intelligence Digest, filing reports with them, had written a letter to H.L. Hunt, who was one of the principal funders of the Foreign Intelligence Digest, saying, I would like to have a clarification of my employment with you. And this letter is hidden by the FBI and the CIA during the investigation. And you discover that a man by the name of Richard Nagel, in the first week of November of 1963, goes into a bank down in El Paso, Texas, and fires a pistol into the ceiling and then lays it down and goes out and sits in his car waiting for the police to come and get him. And when they come, he says, you'll probably want to look in the trunk of my car. And they open up the trunk of his car and they find photographs of Lee Harvey Oswald on an ID form using the name, A. Hadell, and they find photographs of Richard Nagel on IDs using the name A. Hadell in the same container. And you find out that Richard Nagel worked for the Foreign Operations Intelligence, which was set up basically by the exact same people, H.L. Hunt and Charles Willoughby and William Pawley, at the same time. And Richard Nagel says to the arresting officers, "I'd rather be arrested for bank robbery than be in Dallas later this month." And this is in the first week of November. So when you when you discover that Richard Nagel, as an agent for the field operations intelligence, was in fact posted to the Japanese military base where Lee Harvey Oswald was based when he was working as in the United States Marine Corps. In the base where the U-2s flew out of in Japan, and Lee Harvey Oswald was patronizing a local bar where the bar, what they call them bar girls at that time, which gave you some sense of their levels of consciousness, where the bar girls were soliciting information from some of the men who worked at the base, trying to find out from them what they did there and what was going on there. And Lee Harvey Oswald reported this to his immediate superior, and his immediate superior then assigned him to go back to the bar and to get the names and identification of the women that were doing this. And then a man showed up from a civilian intelligence agency to give money to Lee Harvey Oswald for him to use to spread around at the bars to get more contact with these women and to get information from them and give them false information about what was going on at the base, at the U-2 base, so they could track that false information through the network and to determine what it is, and you discover that that man is Richard Nagel, working for the field operations intelligence. And you find out that Lee Harvey Oswald is then later working for Foreign Intelligence Digest after he comes back from Russia, because in working with Richard Nagel in doing this kind of low-level intelligence gathering at the base in Japan, he then gets so excited about this kind of work that he ends up being recruited into a program that sends him to North Carolina to be trained in a special program. It's called Illusionary Warfare. And it's working together in tandem with a project that's called Operation Redskin. And he is sent to the Language Academy here in Monterey to learn Russian, and is then allowed to leave the United States Marine Corps just for writing a letter to them telling them he'd like to leave the Marine Corps because his mother needs him at home because a can of beans fell off her shelf and hit her on the nose, and she needs his help. And so they release him from the United States Marine Corps, and he goes home, and within a week, he's on a plane flying to Russia. When you start to discover those kind of things, and you discover that Lee Harvey Oswald, after he got back from Russia, is escorted around in Texas by a fellow by the name of George de Morenshield. And George de Morenshield brings Lee Harvey Oswald to Collins Radio to get a job down there in Texas. And Collins Radio happens to be the company that the USS Rex has been leased to, that in the first week of November had tried to do a landing party in Cuba of Miami anti-Castro Cubans. And you find out that the USS Rex that is leased by Collins Radio is in fact the ship that was refueling the Flying Tiger when they went on Operation Tilt to go into Cuba back in June of 1963 to try to assassinate Fidel Castro. You begin to wonder, why is it that de Morenshield brought Lee Harvey Oswald to Collins Radio to get a job that were the lessors or lessees of the USS Rex, which is in fact a Central Intelligence Agency ship, because they found the records that show that the mooring costs for the USS Rex were paid for by the Central Intelligence Agency. Okay? And so these are some of the questions that one would begin to ask once you started discovering those pieces of information. But of course, these pieces of information were not in fact revealed to the American public. In fact, these particular pieces of information were in fact actively concealed by both the FBI and the Central Intelligence Agency. After Lee Harvey Oswald was taken into custody for allegedly killing police officer J.D. Tippit down in Dallas. Not for shooting the president, but taken into custody on the suspicion of having shot police officer J.D. Tippit, who happened to be one of the best friends of a man by the name of Carl Mather, who worked for Collins Radio. So that these are, at first glance, disparate facts that make it hard to understand what this implies. But the fact is, we were all spared that type of anxiety because these facts were all concealed from everybody. And it's taken us some time to dig this information out. Because as you'll recall, as I told you earlier, in 1972, when I was working at the office of Attorney F. Lee Bailey, our office was retained to represent Watergate burglar. Where's our little Watergate? There's the Watergate over here. We were retained to represent Watergate burglar James McCord. And James McCord was a CIA wiretapping specialist. And he was arrested in the Watergate Hotel with Virgilio Gonzalez, Eugenio Martinez, and Bernard Barker, all three of whom turn out to be gunmen for Santos Trafficante, who was the Don of the Mafia in Havana prior to January of 1959, and was business partners with Batista and with Paul Helliwell of C Supply Corporation that were handling the heroin imports and sending some of the profits to Commerce International, run by William D. Pawley, to supply military equipment to the Kuomintang. And so you say to yourself, why are three anti-Castro Cubans in the Democratic National Headquarters on the night of June 17th of 1972 in the company of not only James McCord, but also Frank Sturgis and E. Howard Hunt, who you will recall were the coordinating CIA liaisons to two of the paramilitary bases that were in southeastern United States, from which Operation 40 was functioning in launching the paramilitary attacks against the island of Cuba back in 1959 and 1960 and 61. So why are these guys in the Democratic National Headquarters on June 17th of 1973, along with this guy James McCord, and later these two were caught as being the coordinators of the burglary? Why were they in there? What were they doing in the Democratic National Headquarters in June of 1972? And what does that mean? Those are some of the things that we're going to be discussing starting on Monday. Because what I want to do is I wanted to have you be familiar with, not memorize, and not have to be tested on this, even multiple choice. We're not going to do any of that. But I just wanted you to have this chart so that you see the pieces of this, so that you can see that these private agencies basically emanate from around this power base here. That this power base, and that Alan Dulles is the key to this, because he's the lawyer for the Brown Brothers Harriman. He's a senior partner at Sullivan and Cromwell. And he, in fact, is the guy who was the consigliere for these people, which is a mafia term, actually, for, as I mentioned, a wartime legal counsel that knows how to get things done. So this is the setting that we have in front of us here. This is the group that was confronting President Kennedy as of the end of the summer of 1963. When he had spent the better part of 1963 moving into place steps to respond to the shock that he experienced during the Cuban Missile Crisis by the Joint Chiefs of Staff voting to attack the island of Cuba and generate a Third World War. And he had set his face against them, even to the point of having these private exchanges with Khrushchev moving toward disassembling the nuclear warheads of the United States military and the nuclear warheads of the Soviet Union. The broker for which deal was going to be Pope John the 23rd, so that both men, Khrushchev and Kennedy, trusted him entirely. And it's important to note that the Soviet Union always thought it was to their advantage to have the nuclear missiles all disbanded, because it was the United States that had initiated the atomic bomb. It was the United States that had initiated the hydrogen bomb. It was the United States that had initiated the massive intercontinental ballistic missiles. It was the United States that was designing this entire nuclear warfare as their mode of establishing international hegemony around the world. And the Soviet Union was responding to them by trying to keep up with them and trying to match them. But the Soviet Union had persisted in making recommendations to the United Nations and other places that all of the nuclear weapons in the world be disassembled. And they had agreed over and over again to do that. And the United States kept on saying, all of these people kept on saying over and over again, oh, you can't trust the Russians, you can't trust them. They violated every single treaty they've ever been a part of, which is all turns out to be totally untrue. Just totally untrue. The Soviets had abided by virtually every single agreement that they'd ever entered into with the United States. Because it was to their advantage to do so. Because you need to remember, they started back in October of 1917 as this tiny kind of upstart revolutionary group, you know, in the face of one of the great world powers that had just come out of World War I, you know, basically winning World War I and becoming a major hegemonic power in the world. And so that the Soviet Union was working its way into trying to stand up against them and to become the representative of a socialist movement around the world to oppose the Caucasian-driven, nation-state-based, you know, capitalist imperialism of the world. These are the guys that were doing it. These were the guys that were behind that entire operation. And so, which is not, and I hasten to point out, which is not to make any type of excuses for the Soviet Union or their policies after Stalin came into power and what he did in transforming the entire originally rather idealistic world socialist movement into a simple arm of nationalist, you know, imperialistic motives on Stalin's part, and suppressing human rights and in setting up the gulags and all the other horror stories that one can and is duty bound to hold against them for what they had done. But the reality is that these are the guys that were doing it, and this is what they were doing, and they had every reason to believe that Kennedy was going to go along with that because of who his father was and what his attitudes were that had been expressed in support of Hitler. And so this is what he was confronted by, okay, in the fall of 1963. Andrew?
Is there any evidence of this group kind of playing both sides of the Cold War and having...
Well, it's interesting that there is a very minority perspective on this, and it goes, but it usually ends up grounding out in a very nasty kind of anti-Semitic energy of saying that the Rothschilds and the Jewish cabal of bankers were actually funding the rise of the Bolsheviks, and that they were funding the Soviet Union, and what they were doing is they were funding both sides of the Cold War so that they could make money. That I've looked into that. I'm not convinced about that at all, because it's sort of an Occam's razor type of understanding, because given how obvious it was what they were doing here and what they were mounting, and that they had every desire to win, these guys are, they have every advantage to be gained by establishing unilateral military hegemony over the whole world. They don't have to be opposed by some other group, except, you know, they used that as I said, as a dialectic, that they kind of hold it forward as a second paradigm dialectic. Oh, there's this horrible group that are trying to take over the world, and as George Carlin said, that's our job. And so that they would put that forth constantly as the rationale for what they were doing. But the great lie was put to that at the end of the Cold War, because as soon as the Soviet Union voluntarily dissolved itself and stood back from the entire Cold War, these guys never missed a step. I mean, they moved right straight on to advocating in that 1992 United States Defense Department policy planning guidance document that we increase our military budget and establish full-scale unilateral military hegemony over the whole world, which they identified as full-spectrum dominance. You know, now the argument still has another dimension to it, which is it didn't take them very long to end up identifying another ultimate other. But that was only because of the surprising resistance that was raised to their occupation of the Middle Eastern oil fields by the Wahhabists and the Muslim Brotherhood, that I don't doubt at all, from having reviewed all the records, that they anticipated anything like what was happening. They did not anticipate the fact that the fascists who were put into power at the end of World War I, you know, these royalist families, the Abdulaziz in Saudi Arabia, the Kuwaiti royal family, the Pahlavis, you know, they didn't anticipate that they were all going to be ousted, you know, at the end of the Cold War. They didn't think that was going to happen. They thought they were going to be able to establish and maintain their hegemony. So I don't believe that the major functioning dynamic beneath this world history that we're talking about is some group of Jewish bankers, the Rothschilds, that are also in cahoots with the Queen of England and the Bank of England, in basically funding both sides and sitting back and making lots and lots of money. And I don't mean to caricaturize that position that is taken, but I don't think it's that credible. Though there are some pieces of information around that might be a little bit supportive of that. Yeah. So what else? This has to raise a lot of questions with you guys. You know, or other questions you have about other pieces of this, because we're going to be that I'm assuming that all of you will have this completely memorized by next week. so that when we start talking about the particulars that that started happening in November of 1963, that little bells will be going off all the time when we encounter things that cross over these people when they show up. That, for example, when in fact it's discovered that you wonder what I'm looking for, right? I guess it'd help if I could think of the name of it, right? Where is this? We reconfigured this a little bit just before we came out of here. That where is this? Oh, here it is, the Anderson Trust. Okay, that this Anderson Trust, remember that I said has Robert Lovett and Robert Anderson and John J. McCloy, it was all set up because Lansdale, Edward Lansdale, who was the G2 in the Philippines, contacted General MacArthur, flew there when he discovered that these 12 troves had been discovered, and had the meeting with Charles Willoughby and General MacArthur, and then Lansdale and Willoughby went to Washington and met with Truman. When you find that Ed Lansdale was standing in Dealey Plaza and was walking past the hobos that were taken out of a boxcar immediately behind the grassy knoll that are being paraded out of the boxcar by the police department, and you see Ed Lansdale happened to be there walking past the tramps, and that he's identified by his wife and by Fletcher Prouty, who was the head of the Joint Special Operations Agency that worked directly with the CIA and Lansdale, and you say, what is Lansdale doing in Dealey Plaza? And you discover that Rip Robertson here, who is part of the Berlin operating base with Theodore Shockley and McCloy and Dulles and the others, with David Morales, and when you notice that Rip Robertson, who is over here in Operation Tilt, Rip Robertson is the guy that was the field commander of the people that were going in to assassinate Fidel Castro in June of 1963, when you see that Rip Robertson is standing on the curb as President Kennedy's limousine goes past him, and he is tipping his hat to the president, looking directly at him, 1.2 seconds before the first shot hits the president. And he's the head of the S Force. He is the operations, field operations commander of the S Force. It's been put together to assassinate Castro, you know? And so you say, what is Lansdale? What are Lansdale and Rip Robertson doing in Dealey Plaza on November 22nd of 1963? What are they both doing there? Okay, so that, These are going to be some of the questions that get posed to us starting on Monday, and we're going to, well, again, I don't want to bog you down in all of the details, you know, of all the names of the witnesses that were at the shooting of J.D. Tippit, but I want you to become familiar with the facts of what happened around the shooting, so that you can be fluent, at least in the major facts of it, because otherwise you're in a generation that otherwise is going to grow up and go off into the world and basically not know any more about the assassination than what you hear out of a far distant corner of your ear for the rest of your life. So I want you to become familiar with what the details surrounding the assassination are, and how it is that when you look at it with this history in mind, that and you see that Rip Robertson is there, and Lansdale is there in the plaza, you begin to realize that something is happening here. That out of all the places that they could be, and when you discover that there is a meeting that takes place at 11 o'clock at night, the night before November 22nd, and it's at the home of Clint Murchison, Sr., in Dallas, and that Clint Murchison, Jr. is the owner of the ranch in Oaxaca, Mexico, where the S-Force was trained in the Triangular Fire Team training to assassinate foreign heads of state. And you discover that there's a meeting that takes place at Clint Murchison's home at 11 o'clock on the night of November 21st. And in this meeting is Lyndon Johnson, Richard Nixon, J. Edgar Hoover, and Clint Murchison Jr., that owned the ranch where the Triangular Team was trained, and you have four different witnesses who testify to that event having taken place, and that one of them then says, who is confirmed to have been the fairly long-time mistress of Lyndon Johnson, swears that when Lyndon Johnson arrived and they went into this side conference room at the house and came out, and Lyndon Johnson said to her, I'm not going to have those sons of bitches Kennedys bothering me anymore after tomorrow. You know, that you begin to understand the seriousness and the gravity of what is happening here. And so that I want you to, until we start next week on Tuesday, I want you to focus on this. I want you to fully grasp and absorb the structure of what it is that confronted President Kennedy at the end of the summer of 1963, when he had decided that he was going to turn on these people and was going to disassemble the nuclear warheads of the United States arsenal in coordination with Khrushchev and with earlier in the summer working with Pope John the 23rd. So I want you to keep that in mind over the weekend. But we're now scheduled to go on over to the other room and have our discussions about this. And so I'm just suggesting you may start asking 1,000 questions about the assassination itself. But we want to hold those till next week when you've really had an opportunity to get a lot of the information, okay? But the questions about this structure and who these people are and stuff are all fair game for and starting at 6 o'clock, okay? Terrific, you guys. Thank you. Now don't lose your chart. You want to keep this under your pillow?